Well, thank you for joining us. Welcome to Grace once again. It wouldn't be proper to conclude our study of the believer's patience of hope, which will be, as you know, evaluated at the judgment seat of Christ for every believer, without looking at the way this second aspect in the spiritual growth of the believer impacts that believer's prayer life in this economy of grace. A question I'm often asked is, what about prayer in this dispensation? What about prayer today? Are believers to pray at all? Is there a special way that we are to pray? And what should we expect when we pray? As the title of a song written a few years back, and some of you may recognize it, is anybody listening? So some of you are old enough to remember when public prayer was being challenged back in the early 60s. A case was brought before the U.S. Supreme Court in 1962 because school officials in New York had drafted a prayer. They'd come up with a specially written prayer, and they then had set aside a time every school day for that prayer to be recited by the classes. The high court ruled that those school officials had violated what is called the Establishment Clause because their prayer had been an officially sanctioned prayer. That was the main thing, and they had no right, the school board, to approve of, much less to draft a prayer in connection with a public school system. But what if those officials hadn't drafted or approved a prayer at all? What if those officials had simply set aside some time for silent prayer? That seems reasonable enough. Well, an Alabama school system thought that did seem reasonable, so they decided that would be the route that they would take. They passed what they called a period of silent meditation, and they called it a period of silent meditation law. But that law hadn't gone far enough as the Alabama legislature's reasons, so they amended it to read a period of silence for meditation or silent prayer. What was the result? Well, once again, the prayer issue went before the Supreme Court of the U.S. in 1985, and the court struck down that Alabama school district policy. How about the reciting of a prayer at a graduation ceremony? After all, that's a special event, and a prayer would maybe help solemnize that milestone for the graduating seniors. So the school officials of a middle school in Providence, Rhode Island, continued to follow their long-standing tradition by inviting a clergyman to offer an invocation and a benediction at that school's graduation ceremony. A couple challenges came up right away, and once again, that case went before the Supreme Court in 1992. Can you guess the results of that case? I think you can by this time. The court ruled against the policy at Nathan Bishop Middle School. Then came the issue of prayer at Santa Fe in Santa Fe, Texas, at a Santa Fe, Texas high school football game. And this one you might be more familiar with. That Texas school district had allowed the students to elect another student from among the student body. And that student, selected student, would be permitted to speak briefly over the PA system prior to the start of each football game. This way the school officials wouldn't be directly involved. They'd allow the students to handle the situation. And while those school officials hadn't told the students what to say, they hadn't drafted a prayer, they knew what was coming. The selected student would, of course, offer a prayer for the safety of the football players on both sides of the field. That case came before the U.S. Supreme Court in the year 1995. And just as it had in the previous cases, the right to public prayer at a school-sponsored event was ruled out of bounds. You can't do it. I can recall seeing bumper stickers back at that time. I'm dating myself, and maybe some of you would remember that, that read, "We still pray." Anyone remember that? Then the opposing side brought out their own bumper decorations that read, "We still think." I happen to prefer the ones that said, "We still think." must prayer be a public oration, I should say, in the first place? Does it have to be public, and does it have to be audible? Can prayer not be silent? Can anyone, Supreme Court included, regulate what's going on in an individual's mind? Some would argue that mind control is not such a far-fetched thing, and we do know that the purposeful shaping of public thought's been going on for as long as I can remember. It's called social engineering. But who can stop anyone from praying in what's often referred to as the silence of the mind? Who can stop what is said or how it is said or when it is said, for that matter, when it's simply a mental process only? Those of like-minded faith can still meet, at least at the present time, and pray audibly if they so choose. How many of you are familiar with the singer-songwriter Bob Dylan? am I dating myself again? It goes back some time. He wrote the song entitled The Times They Are A-Changin'. That song was written back in the 60s, but the truth is the times have been a-changin' since Adam's decision in the garden. And it hasn't been a progression upwards, as we all well know, but it's been a progression in the exact opposite direction, at least where God and Christ, his Christ, are concerned. Many changes have occurred since the founding of our nation. We can bemoan the fact that it's no longer about assimilating into a Christ-based culture, however that may be defined, but about a U.S. where multiculturalism rules the day. And we can lament that fact until the cows come home. There are actually those who are celebrating it. But as it can be expected, where people go, they take their faith systems or lack thereof with them. Within the U.S., still predominantly classified a Christian nation, the word Christian itself has taken on so many different flavors that it's become a meaningless term in more ways than one. So what can we do while the times are changing? What can we do when the term spirituality may or may not have anything whatsoever to do with Jesus Christ and his accomplishment at Calvary where the sins of the world are concerned? We can go back to the book of truth, the Bible, to glean some of those answers. We do know that the prayers of those willing to take God at his word down through the ages have been and continue to be desired by God. Well, it is evident from the word of God that both before and after the call of Paul, God's desire has been to hear from those who are his. So what does the Bible have to say about prayer, and especially about prayer in this dispensation of the grace of God? Can anybody tell me the first prayer mentioned in the Bible? Anyone have a guess as to what that might have been? Who do you suppose offered that prayer? I can tell you right up front, it was not Adam and Eve. It didn't come until Genesis chapter 15, and it shouldn't surprise us that it came from the man who has been called the father of faith. Who would that be? Abraham, who was requesting an heir. That's the first recorded prayer in the book, in the book called the Bible, Abraham. Let's take a quick look at Abram's very short prayer in Genesis chapter 15, verses 2 and 3. And Abram said, Lord God, what wilt thou give me, seeing I go childless, and the steward of my house is this Eliezer of Damascus? And Abram said, behold, to me thou hast given no seed, and lo, one born in my house is mine heir. Well, God answered Abram's prayer, and Sarah bore Abram's son Isaac. As God was establishing the foundation for the very nation that was to be called Israel. As we all know, Isaac sired Jacob, whose name would be changed to Israel, and through Israel came the 12 tribes, 12 sons of Jacob, or Israel. We call them the 12 tribes of Israel. Time wouldn't permit us to go through all the prayers of the Bible, but they've been numbered as 222 prayers where men were actually speaking to God with their words being recorded just as they were spoken. This is not counting the numerous instances in Scripture where someone spoke about how he prayed and what he had stated to God when he prayed, but only those times when we see the actual prayer recorded just as it was spoken. 222, we're told. It's interesting to me that the very first recorded prayer in Scripture came from the founding father of the nation Israel. And that prayer would result in the birth of the second patriarch of that nation that God was establishing after having given the Gentiles over to their reprobate thinking. We all know that God eventually placed the people of that nation under a law contract at Mount Sinai. And from that point forward, as the nation's behavior in accordance with the law contract went, so went the effectiveness of their prayer lives. A telling statement from God as it relates to prayer under the law contract is found in Isaiah chapter 1, verse 15, where the prophet, speaking God's words to the nation, made this statement. And when ye spread forth your hands, I will hide mine eyes from you. Yea, when you make, notice it, many prayers, I will not hear. Your hands are full of blood. Another passage illustrating how their behavior, contrary to the law contract, and their lack of confession of that law contract failure was directly tied to their ability to have God respond positively to their prayers is found in the book of the prophet Jeremiah. First, we see God relate their behavior, beginning in verse 9. Will ye steal, murder, and commit adultery, and swear falsely, and burn incense to Baal, and walk after other gods whom ye know not, and come and stand before me in this house, which is called by my name, and say, we are delivered to do all these abominations? Notice verse 11. Is this house, which is called by my name, become a den of robbers in your eyes? Behold, I have seen it, saith the Lord. They had clearly been in violation of the law of Moses. And through Jeremiah, God was calling these people on the carpet. How did the behavior of the people of Israel affect their prophets' prayers on behalf of the nation? Here it is in a separate verse, and three separate verses actually. The first is Jeremiah chapter 7, verse 16. Therefore, now God's talking to Jeremiah here, therefore pray not thou for this people, neither lift up cry nor prayer for them, neither make intercession to me, for I will not hear thee. That same thought is repeated twice more as we come to chapter 11, verse 14, followed by chapter 14, verse 11. It's interesting how they just reverse. Here in chapter 11, verse 14, God said through Jeremiah, therefore pray not thou for this people, neither lift up a cry or prayer for them, for I will not hear them in the time that they cry unto me for their trouble. Jeremiah 14:11. Then said the Lord unto me, pray not for this people for their good. In other words, for good to happen to them. So from the outset of their departure from Egyptian captivity, the people of Israel had proven their lack of faith in the Most High God who had delivered them. Rather than casting themselves upon his name, as we talked about earlier in this series, and trusting him to put his compound name, Jehovah name, into effect for them and do so graciously, all they had to do was call upon that name, and he would answer them. But they refused to do so. They were trusting in gods who were not gods at all, according to what God had told the prophet. How did the Lord respond to what they were doing? He refused to heed the prayers of the prophets, telling them not to pray on Israel's behalf, and he also refused to hear the prayers of the people, the Bible just told us. Notice their behavior and their mindset as they were now standing on the threshold of the land that God had promised them. Here it is in Deuteronomy chapter 32, verses 16 through 19. They provoked him to jealousy with strange gods. With abominations provoked they him to anger. They sanctified unto devils, not to God, to gods whom they knew not, to new gods that came newly up, whom your fathers feared not. Of the rock that begat thee, thou art unmindful and hast forgotten God that formed thee. They were in clear violation of the law contract. Now notice Deuteronomy 32, verses 19 and 20. And when the Lord saw it, he abhorred them because of the provoking of his sons and of his daughters. And he said, I will hide my face from them. I will see what their end shall be. For they are a very froward generation, children in whom is no faith. For those who are not familiar with that term froward, it simply means perverse or contrary. They could always pray. They could have always prayed, admitting the failure of their nation under the law contract and pleading with God to put his compound Jehovah name into effect for them graciously, as God desired that they do. And God would have responded positively to their request. But the people of the nation didn't do that. Instead, they spoke against God while journeying through the wilderness, as we well know. And when the second generation actually entered into the land, they honored the false gods of the people groups that were around them. Now, whenever you see that the expressions hide my face from them or hid my face from them, both are found in Scripture, you know that God was not responding favorably to the prayers of the people of his nation. In fact, he refused to hear those prayers, as we just read. Two passages from Isaiah sum up the connection between Israel's obedience to the law contract and God hearing and responding favorably to their prayers. There are Isaiah chapter 30, verse 9, and Isaiah chapter 59, verse 2. Let's look at both verses, and we'll look at them back to back. That this is a rebellious people, lying children, children that will not hear the law of the Lord. They refused to hear the law of the Lord. Would God refuse to hear their prayers is the question. Well, here it is in Isaiah 59, 2. But your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you that he will not, next word, here. Do you see the connection between Israel's obedience according to the law contract and the ability of the people of the nation to get God to answer, to hear, much less answer, their prayers? There was a direct connection in prayer and the law, behavior under the law, not carried on through. was the law contract program, we might call it, still in effect during the time of Christ's earthly ministry to the nation of Israel? Who would say, yes, it was? Of course it was. The answer is it most certainly was. The law program was the program of that day. Now we can see why Christ could say what he did, as recorded in John's Gospel, John chapter 15 and verse 7. If ye abide in me, a conditional clause, by the way, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask whatever you want. You shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. You see why he could say that? As explained in an earlier lesson, abiding in Christ and having Christ's words abide in you was a different thing from the one flesh union relationship called Holy Spirit, or established by the Holy Spirit. Our believers are baptized into the person of Christ himself at the point of their belief, which is the core of the mystery revealed to and through the Apostle Paul. While the law program remained in operation, believing in Christ as Messiah, taking his words to heart, which included participating in John's baptism with water for the remission of sins, along with adhering to Christ's directions, was directly tied to the believer's prayer life. If ye abide in me and my words abide in you, then ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. Did Christ place a requirement on abiding in him at that time? The answer is yes, he did. We see the requirement for abiding in Christ and abiding in Christ's love during the time of the law program as we come to verses 9 and 10 of the same chapter. As the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. Now, continuing in Christ's love was an exhortation. It wasn't an automatic expectation. How could the people of Israel continue in Christ's love? Christ told them in verse 10, if ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide or be at home in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. What were Christ's commandments, you might ask? They were the two commandments set forth by Christ in Matthew chapter 22, where Christ was responding to the Pharisees' question as to which is the great commandment of the law. You'll probably recall what these two are. Christ's response came in verses 37 through 40, a passage that should be very familiar to most of us here that have been following our studies. Matthew 22, beginning with verse 37, Jesus said unto them, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. He said, if you want to abide in my love, keep my commandments. And the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. So to abide in Christ at that time, and therefore to abide in his love, was to have Christ's words resonant, as I said, in your heart, and to be standing on those words in faith. It had to do with following Christ and making his words the operating principle of your life if you were a Jewish believer in Christ as the Messiah. And keep in mind that these two commandments given by Christ was his exhortation to the nation during the time when the law program was still in operation. Christ had yet to die at Calvary when he spoke those words. Therefore, the law had yet to be nailed to the cross of Christ. As I stated in our previous lesson, abiding in Christ at that time had nothing at all to do with being baptized into Christ by the Holy Spirit at the point of a person's belief. The spiritual union or oneness of all believers with Christ as an operation performed by the Holy Spirit was revealed to Paul as part of the mystery that he might make that truth known unto all men. And that spiritual union wouldn't become a reality until Christ's resurrection from the dead. Now, stay with me here for a moment. While the law program with the nation Israel was still in operation, was there not a connection between obedience to the law and the Jewish believer's prayer life? Of course there was. As long as that law was in operation, prayer and the law were, and obedience to the law were tied hand in hand. We watched it unfold just a moment ago as we look back at the law. As you recall, God wouldn't even hear the prayers of the prophets on the nation's behalf while that nation was operating contrary to the commandments of God. And it wasn't just the prayers of the prophets, as we saw, that God might bring the nation good, that God wouldn't hear. It was the prayers of the people themselves who had been walking contrary to God's commandments that he refused to heed. He said, I will not hear them when they pray. What had the prophet Isaiah said in the passage we noted a few moments ago? Isaiah 59:21-2. But your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you, that he will not hear. But then Christ came along, God in the flesh, born a Jew under law, teaching the Jews who were under the law. And he boiled that law down, we could say, to two commandments. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, and thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Christ's exhortation was to keep his two commandments if they wished to abide in his love and have whatever they wanted, whatever they desired. And if they were abiding in his love, what could they expect? They could expect their prayer life to be affected in a positive way. As Christ told them in John chapter 15, verse 7, if ye abide in me and my words in you, ye shall ask what ye will. And it, not might, could, should, would, it will. It shall be done unto you. I believe this is precisely what James was talking about as he was writing to those from the 12 tribes which were scattered abroad in the book of James. Those from the 12 tribes, I should have said. It wasn't all of the 12 tribes. But those from among the 12 tribes when they fled that area of Jerusalem, around Jerusalem, and they fled to those outlying regions. James wrote to those people, and we're going to read his words in James chapter 5, verse 15, where James stated, and the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up, and if he have committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. Had the cross taken place yet? Oh, we're getting a little better flavor as to when the book of James was written. Now, you Bible scholars are going to have to think with me here for a moment. This is for the more seriously minded students of the word. Was the law program still in operation during the time when James wrote his letter to those people from the 12 tribes who had fled to the outlying regions? When had they fled? We often think of the fleeing, the dispersion, the diaspora of the Jews at the stoning of Stephen. But what we're learning here is that isn't the case. Many had already fled prior to the stoning of Stephen. So we're going to look at that in a moment. Jews had been fleeing from Saul of Tarsus during the entire time of Christ's earthly ministry, if you think about it. Jews had been fleeing from Saul's persecution of the Jewish saints from the time of Christ's earthly ministry to Israel until Saul's conversion on the road to Damascus. The question I want you to ponder is this. Could James have been written, could he have written his letter to those scattered saints during the time of the one-year extension that was given to the nation after Christ's resurrection in connection with the parable of the fig tree? I think we can easily lock it down now. Scholars, and I don't care what commentary you'll find, nobody will date James. The only thing all of them say is James was written early on, very early on, but we can't tell you exactly when. We know the law program was still in effect. We also know there's no mention of Christ, no mention of the cross, no mention of the mystery, no mention of anything like that, that James had to have been written when the law program was in effect and obedience to the commandments of God, of Christ, affected the believer's prayer life. Think about that for a moment. As I said, every commentary will say very early on, but I think we can nail it down to that one-year period of time. For a time, I had come to believe, and this was recently, I had come to believe that James must have known Paul's gospel by the time he wrote this letter. I mentioned that in an earlier lesson, I believe. After all, James talked about the perfect law of liberty, did he not? Yes, he did. In his letter, and he talked about allowing patience to do its perfect work. Does Paul not talk about those things? Does Paul not mention our liberty? Stand fast in the liberty worth. Christ has made us free. And Paul talked about patience in relation to our patience of hope and how patience works experience, and experience ends up in hope. Paul told the saints in Galatia to stand fast in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free. He also talked about patience working experience, as I just told you. This might lead some to believe, as it had me, that James must have known Paul's gospel when he was writing his letter. I now think totally differently. When James talked about the perfect law of liberty, he didn't have Paul's gospel in mind. James had the two commandments of Jesus Christ in mind, as James called the perfect law of liberty the royal law according to Scripture in James chapter 2, verse 8. Let's take a quick look at that passage. If he fulfill the royal law according to Scripture, he's telling them what Christ told them. If you do these commandments and abide my love, you can ask whatever you want. Now James is saying, if he fulfill the royal law according to Scripture, writing to the Jews, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself, ye do well. I guess they would. How and where would those folks do well, we might ask? And what again was the royal law according to Scripture that James had in mind? what scripture was James referring to? That becomes obvious as we look a little more closely. The first of the Ten Commandments was that Israel have no gods, no other gods above the one true God. What was the royal law? The first of the royal, love the Lord thy God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And in Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18, God told Israel, centuries before James ever came upon the scene, love thy neighbor as thyself. So Christ was repeating the words of the law when he gave the royal law. These were the same two commandments that Christ was exhorting Israel to follow in order to have the desires of whatever they asked for. When James talked about the royal law, it was those two commandments of Christ that James had in mind. Christ himself had said, on these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Even though James had a future judgment of Jews in mind in his letter, which I fully believe, and we'll explain that more fully when we look at the circumcision epistles and look at James, James wouldn't have had to know anything at all about Gentiles being saved apart from Israel's program, or about a new dispensation, or about the gospel of Christ. It's now my firm belief that James was written while the law program was still in operation, and Christ had already died, was buried, and had already risen again. So James had to have been written, just as the commentators say, early on. It had to have been written during the one-year extension Israel's given in the parable of the fig tree. James was simply echoing the words of Christ, as Christ had directed the Jews to abide in him and allow his words to abide in him, his commandments, and that if they would do so, their prayer life would be affected positively. What would be the result for believers of that day who obeyed those two commandments of Christ? Well, there they are. Christ just revealed that a moment ago in John chapter 15, verse 7. If ye abide in me and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. This was called the prayer of faith while the law program was still in progress. And what was James telling the Jews who had fled Saul's persecution? And in his letter, he said, the prayer of faith shall save the sick. After all, that's precisely what Christ had promised them. The prayer of faith was how God was dealing with the Jewish believers while the law program remained in operation. And the prayer of faith promises in connection with their abiding in Christ and his words abiding in them during the time of the law are numerous. Listen to Christ's words in Matthew chapter 21, verse 21, and we know the law was still in operation. Jesus answered and said unto them, verily I say unto you, if ye have faith and doubt not, ye shall not only do this which is done to the fig tree, but also if ye shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, be thou cast into the sea, it shall be done. And all things, next word, whatsoever ye shall ask in prayer, believing, ye shall receive. The law program was still in operation at the time of Christ's earthly ministry to the nation Israel. Let's not leave out the words of Christ as recorded in John chapter 14, verses 12 through 14, on the same subject. Verily, verily, truly, truly, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, obviously a reference to those who are abiding in Christ with his words abiding in them, the works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father, and whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Christ said that truth, that for those who were abiding in him and his words abiding in them, he would do whatsoever they asked. And he said that after he returned to the Father. The question is this: how long after Christ returned to the Father had God given Peter to cultivate a positive response for the nation? The answer is 1 year. That's the 1 year sitting in the parable of the fig tree. God gave them that additional year, and so therefore God honored the contract that he had placed them under at Mount Sinai for that additional 1 year time period. Now put it together. James was well aware of Christ's earthly ministry because James noted the royal law, the commandments handed down by Christ, that had actually been a part of the law contract in the first place. James, in his letter, spoke about how abiding in Christ's love by keeping these commandments would result in the fact that the prayer of faith would heal the sick. James was obviously written, folks, during the time of Israel's one-year extension while God was still honoring the contract under which he had placed the nation. Notice the unlimited nature of this prayer of faith. This prayer of faith promised for those who chose to abide in Christ and follow the royal law. Here it is in this single statement by Christ in the very next verse, verse 14. If ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. He keeps repeating himself to the nation. If ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. So without a question, if they would fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, they would do well, just as James had stated. If they asked anything at all in his name, he would do it. Does that not sound like doing very well to you? Does to me. No wonder James said the prayer of faith shall save the sick. John wasn't the only one to write about the prayer of faith promises of Christ to the people of the nation, as we see these same truths relate in the book of Matthew. Notice Christ's words as recorded by Matthew in Matthew chapter 18, verse 19. Again I say unto you, he keeps repeating himself, that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. Have you ever tried that out today? Christ went on to repeat that prayer of faith promise in Matthew chapter 21, verse 22, where he echoed his earlier words, all things whatsoever you shall ask in prayer believing, you shall receive. He couldn't say it enough times to them. The 12 apostles of the nation Israel were obviously abiding in Christ, and his words were abiding in them as they exercised a prayer of faith in a prayer of faith prayer meeting described in the book of Acts. Let's take a quick look at that prayer of the apostles and the result of their prayer of faith prayer meeting. Some of you, I'm sure, are familiar with what's coming, but I'll set the stage for those who might not be. The 12 apostles that God had given to the nation Israel had met for the purpose of uniting together in prayer as they were being subjected to tremendous persecution by the Jewish rejectors of Jesus Christ as being the legitimate Messiah of Israel. I think we can safely assume that Paul, formerly Saul of Tarsus, had been among those Jewish rejectors of Christ's true identity. So the apostles gathered together to pray. Paul would have been one they were praying to God about, if you think about it. Christ had promised that they would have whatsoever they asked. There were at least two of them in this prayer meeting, more than that. So for those abiding in him and his words abiding in them, they could ask whatever they wanted. And now this group is getting together for a prayer meeting, and they had received the unction in the upper room prior to this prayer meeting. So the prayer meeting of the apostles was beginning to get fully underway as they began offering their prayer of faith in Acts chapter 4, verses 29 and 30. And now, Lord, behold their threatenings. Now stop there for just a moment. Let's take a quick look at what Paul had been doing during this very same time, very same one-year time period as recorded in Acts chapter 9, verse 1. And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went into the high priest. Can you imagine why they were having that prayer meeting? Paul was one they were praying about. This was within that one-year time period after Christ's resurrection and the conclusion of the extension mentioned in Luke chapter 13. God was still honoring the law contract during that period of time, folks. The 12 were praying in light of what Paul, then Saul, and other Christ rejectors were doing. Do you see why many of the Jewish believers were fleeing? They didn't all wait till Stephen was stoned and then everybody take off. They were fleeing for the entire time of Christ's earthly ministry, and they were fleeing from the man named Saul of Tarsus, who was breathing out threatenings against them. Now let's go back to the prayer of faith prayer meeting for a moment in Acts chapter 4, verses 29 and 30. And now, Lord, as they started praying, behold their threatenings, and grant unto thy servants that with all boldness they may speak thy word, by stretching forth thine hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done by the name of thy holy child Jesus. Well, Christ had promised them. Hadn't he made that promise? He had promised they would have whatever they requested. Had he not said, if she shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. That was his prayer promise for those abiding in him. Did God keep his word when the 12 prayed at that prayer of faith prayer meeting? Well, notice verse 31. And when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness. That's exactly what they required, what they requested, rather. Their prayer was answered. To be filled with the Holy Ghost, keep in mind, was to be controlled by the Holy Ghost. It had nothing to do with having a greater amount of the Holy Spirit in them. It had only to do with the Holy Spirit exercising a greater amount of control over them. Did God bring forth the healings that the 12 had requested in that prayer of faith prayer meeting? Jump ahead with me to Acts chapter 5, verses 15 and 16. Insomuch that they brought forth the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and couches, that at least the shadow of Peter passing by might overshadow some of them. There came also a multitude out of the cities. The Rose Bowl parade. I mean, the streets were filled with people here. there came a multitude out of the cities round about unto Jerusalem, bringing sick folks and them which were vexed with unclean spirits, and they were healed. How many? Every one. Christ had come. Christ had taught them. Christ told them to abide in him and to allow his words to abide in him, that would have had to abide in them, which would have been the two commandments he set forth. And for those who chose to follow his exhortation, he set forth some very unconditional prayer promises. Then Christ ascended back into heaven. But what economy continued in operation at that time and would continue in operation until the time of the parable of the fig tree was fulfilled, until it run its course? The answer is the law economy. The law economy. The law dispensation was in full operation as God was continuing to work with Israel on a national level, a national basis, until that one-year extension sitting in the parable of the fig tree had run its course. Listen to James once again, and this time we'll add verses 14 and 16 to the mix. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church, and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick. And the Lord shall raise him up, and if he have committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. Confess your faults one to another, and pray for one another that ye may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Confess your faults one to another is not get together and tell everybody what you did to somebody else. Confess your faults to one another was admit to the person when you've slighted them in some manner. Admit it to them. Confess it to them what you've done. Who is considered to be a righteous man at that time? The prayer of a righteous man availeth much. A righteous man was a man who was abiding in Christ with Christ's words abiding in him. Abiding in Christ was an exhortation at that time, and the following of that exhortation was directly tied to the prayer of faith. The words of James make much more sense when we see them in light of what abiding in Christ with his words abiding in them meant prior to the conversion of God's new apostle of grace, the Apostle Paul, and the revelation of the mystery with its one baptism resulting in the one flesh union of all believers with the person of the Savior. This letter that James had written to dispersed Jews was obviously written during the time of the one-year extension. It was written after Christ died, was buried, and rose again, and it was written before the parable of the fig tree had run its course, because the law in obedience was tied to what you'd get in your prayer life. Obviously written during that one-year extension of Israel's national program, as seen in the parable of the fig tree in Luke chapter 13. It goes hand in hand, folks, with the prayer promises Christ made in connection with the two commandments he gave to the nation, the royal law according to Scripture, while the law program was still in progress. James would have had no knowledge whatsoever of the mystery revealed to the Apostle Paul and the reality of the new economy that would take place as at the soon coming stoning of Stephen, as his letter would have been written before the change of economy took place, and therefore long before the appearance of Paul at the Jerusalem Council, where James and others would learn of Paul's gospel and the new dispensation that began at the stoning of Stephen. It's very important, as we continue to study God's word, that we be willing to discard what we may have previously held as truth and adopt the new truths that we discover, and then to examine everything else that we may have come to believe in light of those new truths, those newfound truths. While I continue to hold that the judgment seat of Christ will be a judgment for all believers, past and present, at Christ's appearing, as Paul would later reveal and Peter would concur, it also becomes very obvious that James believed the gospel of God. And therefore, James knew and believed that Jesus is the Christ, that he's risen from the dead, and that God had made him Lord. God had made him the judge of the living and the dead. So James did indeed believe in a judgment to come. Paul's just revealed Gentiles are going to be included in that judgment, James, and apart from coming through the nation Israel. James knew that all Jewish believers would stand before the judge, Jesus Christ. But James would have known nothing at all about a new dispensation or Paul's gospel, or that Gentile believers would stand before that very same judgment. Paul would include believing Gentiles being present at that judgment as part of the message he would later add to the prophets, or to the apostles, rather, at the Jerusalem Council. But for now, let's get back to the prayer of faith, prayer promises, which Christ gave to those of Israel who were abiding in him during that one-year extension that God gave to Israel in the parable of the fig tree, Luke chapter 13. All that a Jewish believer in the gospel of God had to do at that time was to call upon a group of the elders, as we just read from James, the elders of the outcalling, have those Jewish assembly leaders anoint him with oil, and that suffering saint would be healed from whatever affliction he may have been suffering. James had said the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up, and if he have committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. The new dispensation had most definitely not begun at this period of time, much less had the revelation of the mystery been made known. The previous economy was still underway while James was writing, and it would continue until Israel's one-year extension was complete, as I've been saying. We know how prayer worked in the previous economy or dispensation. Christ promised a positive response for those who chose to abide in him and to allow his words to abide in them. And James reiterated what Christ had promised when he said the prayer of faith shall save the sick. The question all students of God's word must ask themselves at this time is this: does the prayer of faith in the previous economy work the same way in this present economy called the dispensation of the grace of God? To find the answer to that question, we must look to the one to whom God committed the doctrinal truths concerning this dispensation, and that was the Apostle Paul. Now that the new dispensation is in place, does God desire that believers pray? Number one, the privilege of prayer came from God himself, and that privilege was relayed to the Apostle Paul by the risen, ascended Lord of glory. And so Paul revealed it to us in the next to the shortest verse in the entire Bible. Here it is, as it sits in Paul's epistle on hope, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 17, where the apostle of grace states, pray without ceasing. So yes, God intends for believers in this dispensation to pray. This came in the second letter that Paul ever wrote, and that we know of, at least that made the canon of Scripture. And then an epistle just prior to Paul's final letter that would be added to the canon of Scripture came these words from our apostle as he wrote to Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. I exhort thee, therefore, that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings, and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in God, all godliness and honesty. Do you see a difference in the way that prayer worked during the dispensation of the law and the way prayer works during this dispensation of grace of God? What had God told the prophet Jeremiah he was not to do? Was he to make intercession for all men? Was he to make intercession for unbelieving Israel? You recall God's words in Jeremiah chapter 7, verse 16. I'm just going to repeat them to remind you. Therefore, pray not thou for this people, neither lift up or cry nor pray for them, neither make intercession to me, for I will not hear thee. Now, the new dispensation is in place, and God is no longer dealing with Israel on a national basis. He's dealing with all men alike, and now we see the Apostle Paul, during this dispensation committed to him, called the dispensation of the grace of God, we see that God chose to reveal the details of this new dispensation, and Paul's exhorting Timothy to make application or supplications, prayers, and intercessions for how many men? For all men. He's not excluding anybody now. Now you can pray for all men. The answer is all men, for kings and all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. Paul wasn't praying that God change the hearts and minds of the kings. Paul was praying that God change the hearts and the minds of the people who were having problem with those kings. Obviously, some things had changed. The way that prayer works is one of those major things. This is where we must again turn to the apostle to whom God committed the information concerning how God is working during this dispensation of grace. We know that it is no longer the prayer of faith shall save the sick. That wasn't a promise that worked on and off, so to speak, at that time. Here a little, there a little, as God saw fit. And it wasn't a limited promise for only certain illnesses and afflictions from which the Jewish people were suffering. Christ had said that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. And those he was speaking to were those that had the unction, those that would be given the unction in the upper room when he breathed on them the same day as he returned. He ascended into heaven, returned the same day as his resurrection, and breathed on them that unction, the Bible tells us. Those who were abiding in Christ, with his words abiding in them, namely the 12 apostles who had been given that unction in the upper room, could pray at any time. And they could pray for anybody who was sick, and it made no difference who it was or the seriousness of the ailment. They could pray for anything, and God would heal that individual. when the multitudes came from outside Jerusalem, bringing sick folks with them, as we read earlier, and those who were vexed with unclean spirits, obviously unbelievers, those people were healed every one, as we just read a moment ago. Why again? The answer is because that's exactly what Christ had promised those people in connection with the prayer of faith, which was the prayer of the 12 apostles during the one-year extension of time while God was honoring the contract he had made with the nation Israel. Now that the new dispensation is in place, we still have the privilege of praying at any time and for anything, according to the Apostle Paul. Listen to Paul in Philippians chapter 4, verse 6. Be careful for nothing. Careful meaning overly anxious in the Greek word there. Be overly anxious for nothing, but in everything, in every situation of suffering, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And God will do as Christ had promised those of Israel who were abiding in him and his words abiding in him, that he would do. The answer is no, because it isn't about healing all manner of sickness and disease in this dispensation. Yes, God validated Paul's apostleship, and he validated Paul's message to Jewish unbelievers who had been born under the law contract during the time of Paul's four journeys, and he did so by way of the miraculous healings we read about and read about in our previous lesson. However, those miraculous healings came to an end after Paul's apostleship had been duly validated in those areas. Otherwise, Paul could have healed Epaphroditus, a believer and a traveling companion of Paul who had become sick nigh unto death, Paul told us in the same book, Philippians chapter 2, verse 25. If the prayer of faith worked in this dispensation of grace as it worked in the previous dispensation while the law contract was still underway, Paul wouldn't have had to tell Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 23, to drink no longer water, Timothy, but use a little wine for your stomach's sake and for your frequent infirmities. If the prayer of faith worked the same way in this dispensation as it worked in the previous dispensation, Paul wouldn't have had to leave Trophimus ill at Miletus. What did all these sick folks who were not delivered from their suffering circumstances share in common? Every one of these people who were not delivered from their suffering circumstances shared something in common. They were all believers in the gospel of Christ. How do we know that? They were traveling companions of Paul. They were in no need of further validation as to the legitimacy of Paul's apostleship or his message. They had already believed it. They were with Paul. They had already become saved and sealed saints. And they had obviously come to an understanding of the way that God is working in the dispensation of grace. As Paul tells us, God revealed it to him when he prayed for his own thorn in the flesh, whatever that may have been. Paul prayed three times to be delivered from his affliction. Was the prayer of faith in operation? What did God tell Paul in answer to Paul's prayer for deliverance? Here it is in 2 Corinthians, for any who may have missed this in our previous lessons, as it appears in chapter 12, verse 9. And he said unto me, "Grace, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me." Why would God allow believers during this present dispensation of grace to continue suffering from the troubling situations that are common unto all men? Paul gives us the answer to that question in the very same book, chapter 4, in verses 15 through 18. It's not an overly long passage, so I'm going to read all four verses. First, verses 15 and 16. For all things are for your sakes, that the abundant grace might through the thanksgiving of many redound to the glory of God. For which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. All things are for your sakes. For our light affliction is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we look not to the things which are seen, but to the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Do you mean to tell us, Paul, that God is allowing believers today to undergo suffering situations that are common to the world, and that he's doing so for our own sakes? The answer is yes. The Bible just told us that. That's what Paul's just said. The purpose, of course, is for the strengthening of our inner man. Though our outward man perish, Paul said, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. In the vernacular of our day, God is saying, I know I'm allowing you to suffer, but I'm doing this for your own good. That's exactly what he's saying. What good might that be, some might be asking. What had Paul told us at the outset of our study of the believer's patience of hope? Tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience results in hope, and hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. When we are suffering outwardly from a situation that we may have not brought on ourselves at all through improper choices, and therefore over which we have no control, that suffering situation helps us to focus on our future hope. And that hope is not for the here and now, but for the hereafter. Our hope is for the new tent that every believer will gain when Christ appears in the air and gifts us with our new bodies. Paul understood that quite well. When speaking of himself, he penned 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 10. Therefore I take pleasure in infirmities. Therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, weak outwardly that is, then I am strong, where? Inwardly. The Greek word translated by the English word infirmities in that passage is asthenia. A dictionary of the Greek language defines asthenia this way: malady, frailty, disease, infirmity, sickness, weakness. When Paul was weak outwardly, through the personal experience of any number of those synonyms for the word infirmities, and I'm sure he suffered from all of them at some time during the course of his ministry, that afforded Paul the opportunity to thank God for the promise that through those things, God would strengthen what I like to think of as the mental muscle that Paul referred to as the inner man. We all have that inner man muscle. It's just that it isn't strengthened when we whine and we complain and worry about the present. If anything, that weakens the inner man, the mental muscle. The inner man is only strengthened when we apply doctrine for this dispensation to our suffering situation, whatever that may be. Hope that is realized in the here and now, Paul tells us in Romans chapter 8, verse 24, is not hope at all. If your hope is realized, if your deliverance from a suffering situation is realized in the here and now, why are you hoping for the new tent? Why are you hoping for that new body that Paul tells us in that same passage will be ours one day? You have nothing to hope for if God keeps repairing the present tent. But he's not doing so, and he's not doing so for our very own good, the Bible tells us. Because our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding eternal weight of glory. While we stop looking at the things which are seen, temporary things, and start looking at the things which are unseen. And one of those things is that new body we will all have one day when all the aches and pains and suffering, whether it be emotional, physical, whatever it is, will be gone and gone forever. Suffering no more. It's a glorious thought. As Paul's inner man was strengthened, Paul could put his hope on display to others who are in desperate need of knowing what Paul's hope was all about. And as we've been saying all along, every believer's patience of hope, patience, underline that word, will be evaluated for either reward or for suffering the loss of reward at the judgment seat of Christ. It's not just about being saved and sealed and then that's over. You don't have to do anything else. You can forget about it. We all will appear at the judgment seat of Christ. And at that judgment seat of Christ, we've already looked at our work of faith. And now we're concluding our study on the believer's patience of hope. Our patience of hope will be evaluated equally as much as our work of faith. This is an evaluation of all believers and all believers of all time. And our patience of hope, that's an incredible thing. And you see Peter talking about that. Paul wanted to be on the reward side of the evaluation that was going to take place at the judgment seat of Christ. Which is why Paul tells us about the purpose of prayer in this present dispensation. Let's close this lesson with a return to Philippians chapter 4. But this time, we'll include verse 7. Be careful, overly anxious for nothing, but in everything, not for everything, in every suffering situation, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick? Not now. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall garrison your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. I'm going to quickly read a couple statements I wrote at an earlier date in connection with prayer in this present dispensation of grace. Here they are. Prayer was never given in this present dispensation to change God's purpose or to change God's perspective of our greater preference. Prayer was given to change our perspective of God's greater purpose. And God's greater purpose in this dispensation is not to strengthen our faith by altering our circumstances. God's greater purpose is to allow us to demonstrate our faith today as we remain inwardly strong in spite of our circumstances. Do you see a difference? Prayer was never given to bring God into alignment with our wants. Prayer was given to bring us into alignment with God's will. Prayer was provided that our trust might be given an avenue of expression. This is what thanking God, no matter our circumstances, is all about for believers of the gospel of Christ. Prayer is the avenue for the expression of our thankfulness and our trust in the midst of our troubling situations. And this is what strengthens the muscle that I call the muscle of the inner man. And this is the essence of the believer's patience of hope, which will be evaluated by the judge, Jesus Christ, at the judgment seat of Christ. So with that, we're going to conclude our study on the believer's patience of hope. And we'll pick it up next week in our next study with our labor of love, and we'll see what that's all about.